Om Jnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshuran Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. I'll continue speaking on the themes that I was speaking of yesterday regarding the Guru Parampara and our role within that. By our, I mean me and all of you. Most of the things I've said before. But it's good to hear all these things, consider all these things, again and again, as we heard Srila Prabhupada also, or any acharya, they must say the same thing, not as in the modern way of thinking that you have to be original and bring up something new, something different. So the teachings of Bhagavad Gita, which Krishna spoke to Vivasvan many millions of years ago, are the same teachings that he imparted to Arjuna, and the same teachings that will be imparted by him again in future, and that he's still imparting in some universe, and in this universe also, through his representatives. So the teachings don't change. And therefore, it is the same teachings that are to be presented again and again. Repetition is necessary for proper understanding, because we have viparyaya buddhihi, viparyaya smritihi, or an opposite way of thinking. Whatever we think is good is not good. Yehi sangsparshaja bhoga dukha yoneya evate adyantavanta konte anateshu ramate buddha. Krishna says that the enjoyment within this material world, it is cause of suffering, beginning in all phases. It's simply suffering. Therefore, an intelligent person doesn't take part in it. This goes against what the whole world thinks. But it's a fact. It has to be said again and again, because our tendency is to try to enjoy this material world. But there's no enjoyment there. How that is so, that is stated in Bhagavad Gita. Then again in Srimad Bhagavatam, Nateshu Ramate Buddha, an intelligent person does not take part in sense enjoyment, material enjoyment. So, in the Bhagavatam, again and again, as you were commenting yesterday, this is stated. Gokul Chandra Prabhu told me yesterday, he's been giving a series of Bhagavatam lectures in a temple in Salem, in which they've been having during this Margali month. Is that still going on? They've been having Bhagavatam lectures there for years, but it seems that the Bhagavatam speakers, somehow or other, they never commented on these verses. They never mentioned them at all. People have been hearing Bhagavatam for years, and they never heard or even imagined that this material world is not the place of our enjoyment. Somehow they left all those verses out. And they're becoming somewhat disturbed on hearing them again and again. I often thought that if we were to, that there's some idea that some of the things in Prabhupada's books are very controversial, so we should leave out all the things that might disturb people. And that would be very good for book distribution. We could sell full sets. We just have a pamphlet left. We could sell a whole Bhagavatam. There'd be nothing left practically. Prabhupada, he gave so many books with the same message. People say, why are Prabhupada's books repetitive? Well, the Bhagavatam itself, all the devotees, they offer prayers to Krishna and they say similar things. Of course, it's not exactly the same. Those who study more deeply can find that actually there are so many nuances, which means shades or subtle, not exactly differences, but different angles of seeing the same thing. So anyway, I may say some things which I've said before. Should be the same thing. Shouldn't be anything different. I mean, if you hear what I say and you find that that resonates with everything that you heard Srila Prabhupada say and was in Prabhupada's books, then that's what it should be, right? If it's something different, then there's something wrong. So this is what we should be hearing. Yesterday I gave that example of the pillar. The pillar can bear a great weight. Here in Rameshwaram, there's the hall with 1,000 pillars. There's several in South India, this 1,000-pillared hall. But in some constructions, you find that there's only one or two pillars, and then a huge weight is borne. So that's, of course, that's a science, how to place it like that. That requires advanced knowledge to understand how to place a pillar in such a way that it can support a massive weight. So that point I needed to make, that in the analogy that if I'm supposed to be like a pillar, the weight is Srila Prabhupada and his teachings. He's heavy. So if I stand up straight and don't try to bend, and I follow without cracks or deviations. Follow means you should follow all the basic rules given. Without cracks, without doubts, or promoting personal, so-called personal interest, then I should be able to bear that weight. We should be able, that weight of the parampara is a very great weight, but it's not a burden. It's not something that is troublesome to us. That example Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur gave, I believe, that a woman, she dresses with so many ornaments, gold ornaments. Nowadays we don't see that except in the jewelry advertisements. Maybe at weddings. I don't go to weddings, so I don't know. But it's a heavy weight. But she nevertheless takes pleasure because she wears those ornaments for the pleasure of her husband. This is maybe an outdated analogy which people may not be able to understand very much. But that's the analogy given. So in the same way, this it's a great weight, the teachings of Srila Prabhupada has given us, the responsibility he's given us. But he also gives us the ability by which we can bear that weight and convey what he has given to others, which is what he wanted to do. Srila Prabhupada was realistic. He knew that he wouldn't be in our direct physical presence very long, so he endeavored to instruct his disciples, give them the knowledge of Krishna consciousness with the understanding that they would carry that on and it would go on for generations. But at the same time, we should understand, just like here in Tamil Nadu, the prominent Vaishnava Sampradaya throughout the centuries has been that of Sri Ramanujacharya. So there are so many disciplic followers of him, and so many great devotees following in his footsteps, initiating others, guiding them, teaching them. But at the same time, the paramount position of Sri Ramanuja in the spiritual life of all his followers in disciplic succession is understood. So both gurus and disciples in that parampara, they understand we're all followers of Sri Ramanujacharya. So in the same way, we're all here. Mostly my disciples are here today, and there are so many disciples of those who are initiating gurus within ISKCON at the present time. So we're all in the same mission. It's all Srila Prabhupada's mission. They're gurus and disciples, but we're all cooperating. We're all serving the same mission. It's not Bhakti Vikas Swami's mission or anyone else's mission. We're all servants of Srila Prabhupada's mission, which is Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur's mission, which is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mission. We're all servants in that. Of course, some devotees within that mission, it's a very great mission, so some devotees may take up specific services in specific areas, geographical areas, and area in the sense of different facets of devotional service. There are so many different facets of devotional service. Book distribution, book production, scientific preaching, village preaching. There are so many different areas. So someone, they may have their mission to serve Srila Prabhupada's mission in one particular area of devotional service. But we should understand that even though different devotees have their mission in life to serve Srila Prabhupada's mission, that we are all servants of Srila Prabhupada's mission. And it's by his mercy that we are all here today and that we can go on in devotional service. Devotees often kindly approach me and ask for my mercy or ask them to give me mercy. And usually I respond to them that Please read Srila Prabhupada's books. That you'll get the mercy of the best mercy, or you'll become eligible to receive that mercy if you follow the instructions. It's otherwise, if we ask for the mercy of a devotee, but we're not prepared to follow anything they say, that's hypocritical. Just like if we go to a doctor and say, cure me, and he says, well, take this medicine, and he says, well, I can't be bothered. Just cure me. They cure, but there's a process, so one has to be prepared to follow that. Sometimes I've heard that some gurus in ISKCON are very merciful, and I'm not. I'm very strict, but from what I can understand is that the real mercy is to say, well, you do this, you do this, you do this, you do this. That will help you to advance in devotional service. I don't see, just like if you go to a doctor, if he just says, you'll get better. You may think, well, that's a very merciful doctor. He didn't give me any nasty medicine. But the actual merciful doctor will give you the medicine and say, it tastes horrible. That's not a very merciful doctor. I want some sweet medicine. I've got diabetes, but I want to eat sweets. So let me find a merciful doctor who will give me sweets. They're very merciful, and then you die. So the real doctor will tell you no sweets and take lots of neem juice. And you may think, oh, what a nasty doctor. But that's the cure. So if I tell the basic things which everyone should be told, don't watch that nonsense TV, don't go to movies, don't do this, don't do that, don't eat kami food. And you may think, well, everyone doesn't say that. Others are more merciful, but you don't get the, if you don't follow, you don't get the effect. Krishna consciousness is a scientific process. There are favorable activities that are conducive for advancing in devotional service. And there are activities which will pratiku. They are non-conducive, or they are inhibiting to advancement in devotional service. So, mercy, with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy, that is, Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu, jibe daya kare, Saparshada Shriya Dhamma Shaha Abhatan. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, being merciful to the jivas, descended from the spiritual world along with his dham, Navadvip dham, and his associates. Atyanta Duralabha Prema Koribare Dan Shikhai Sharanagati Bhakatera Pran. So, too, his mercy is manifested in giving the most rare prem, love of Krishna. But how does he do that? By teaching Sharanagati, the process of surrender, which is the very life of the devotees. So in surrender, the first two principles, Anukulyasya Sankalpa, Pratikulyasya Varjanam. To do whatever is favorable for advancing toward the goal of Krishna consciousness, and to not do all those activities which are impeding our advancement in devotional service. So, I'm not deliberately trying to be unmerciful, but Maybe this is the understanding of mercy that I have imbibed. That to teach what is favorable for advancing in devotional service and what isn't, and to exhort others to follow that. You want mercy? Well, this is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy. Otherwise, if we say mercy, 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 all right, that's okay. But Guru's business is to teach. So, what does he teach? What are the teachings of Shastra? What did Srila Prabhupada teach us? So, if we want mercy, that's all right. But first, we should follow. We say, give me your mercy. But that doesn't mean that you don't follow anything. And you want the honorary degree without following anything. The mercy is the instructions that are given. So, again, it's the cheap idea that is there in the broader Hindu culture, that you just go to sadhu and he blesses you. And that's all. And you get what you want. You can get everything you want. Of course, Nityananda, he blessed Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami in that way. Vrindavane tomar sarva labbahoy. You will get everything you want. Everything you will get in Vrindavan. And Krishnadas Kaviraj, he went to Vrindavan and leading a life of great austerity. He compiled Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. Govinda Lilamrita. I'm not sure when he compiled Govinda Lilamrita. Chaitanya Charitamrita he compiled in Vrindavan. So mercy is there. It's not that there's not mercy. But what is the nature of that mercy? And what we have to do to get that mercy? This should be considered. They may say, well, if you have to do something to get the mercy, then it's not mercy. But mercy is always mercy. That means that we're never qualified to get that mercy. But it's not that, well, now I'm following everything, so Krishna has to come and dance before me. I've chanted 16 rounds for 6 months, and it's about time Krishna came and brought me to the Rasa Leela. But rather, one should prepare one's consciousness by the prescribed methods. Prepare one's consciousness to, first of all, be able to recognize that mercy and to actually desire to receive it. Srila Prabhupada traveled all over the world and preached Krishna consciousness. Some people took it up and others didn't. He gave the same teachings to everyone. It wasn't that he was being more merciful to some and less merciful to others. But some took it and some didn't. Some took it very seriously. Some took it somewhat seriously. Others took it but whimsically. And many others didn't take it at all. So the mercy is there. But we have to prepare ourselves to receive that. We can't demand it. And we can't expect the honorary degree. Srila Prabhupada so many times gave this example. That if you think that, I want to get a university degree, but I heard someone got an honorary degree without actually studying in the course, so I'll wait for them to give me an honorary degree also. It's a foolish proposition. Those who do get an honorary degree, they don't study the course, but they make such a contribution to to that discipline without even formally studying. Therefore, they're given the honorary degree. So there may be some devotees who, without even following the process in a very standard or ordinary way, nevertheless achieve a very advanced position. For instance, they're famous in England and Ireland, our godbrother Tribhuvanath Prabhu, who passed away now, who, he wasn't that strong on regular sadhana. He was often seen at 11 o'clock at night finishing his rounds. But he worked hard day and night and preached and made so many festivals and made so many devotees. And although he wasn't what you would call a scholarly devotee, but he read Srila Prabhupada's books. I don't think he had much of an education. But he had a very clear understanding of all the principles in Prabhupada's books. And he was fearless in every respect. He wasn't afraid to go into universities with all professors and just preach Krishna consciousness very straightforwardly and say all evolutionary theory is all bogus. And without any scientific background, or but just with the teachings of Bhagavad Gita as he had heard them from Prabhupada, he'd just defeat everyone. And they'd be happy because he was, I don't know if they were always happy, but he made many people happy because he was so happy in Krishna's service. So definitely, he got the full mercy of Srila Prabhupada. But we can't say that, well, you don't have to follow everything because, Tribhuvanath Prabhu, he often didn't chant all his rounds in the morning. But then in the morning, it wasn't that he was sleeping all morning. He'd be cooking for the devotees or driving to go to another festival site, or he'd be up all night doing kirtan. He often did that at festivals. So, if you see just one side, well, he didn't follow the standard sadhana program. What did he do? He was fully engaged, high tension, in high intensity, in the preaching mission. So in this way, it's clear that he got the full mercy of Srila Prabhupada. But for almost all of us, we have to follow all the principles very well. That will help us. It's not a dry process. We may think all these rules and regulations, getting up in the morning and this and that, but it's nice to do, it's pleasing. Yenatma supraseedati. We actually become happy by doing so. It's a very happy process. What could be better? What better life is there than this? Living in the association of devotees, not wasting our lives sleeping all morning like almost everyone does. Early in the morning, glorifying Krishna by singing and dancing. What better could we, just see, what could you be doing better? Can you think of anything better? Is there anyone in the universe who has a better opportunity than this? Lord Brahma, I don't know if he comes every day to Mangalati. Of course, he has a long day. So, maybe at the beginning of his day, but actually he's there. Srila Prabhupada in London, when he had the altar made for Radha Landanishwara, He said that you keep two Vyasa signs each side. One is for Brahma and one is for Narada. They're the first acharyas in our sampradaya. Anyway, I'm saying the post of Lord Brahma, not the devotee Lord Brahma. He's busy in various activities overseeing the universe. Whereas devotees, they're chanting Hare Krishna. There's another used to be well-known anecdote from London in this regard, which I heard when I joined. I don't know if that's still told. That it used to be that our devotees in the London temple, they'd have the whole morning program, then they'd go out for Harinam Sankirtan in the morning after breakfast. They'd go up Oxford Street, come back, take lunch, then again go out up Oxford Street, again come back, then shower, and attend the evening program. And that was the program every day, except Sunday. Now, Srila Prabhupada was in London once, and there were just three or four devotees in the temple with him, and everyone else was out. And Prabhupada just started laughing. And the devotee asked, there'd been no conversation or anything. Devotees asked Prabhupada, Prabhupada, why are you laughing? He said, Narad Muni is laughing, Prabhupada said. He's watching the devotees out chanting. He's laughing to see the mlechas chanting Hare Krishna. Mlecha, of course, Prabhupada didn't think of his disciples as mlechas, but laughing in ecstasy to see how the most unexpected people are chanting Hare Krishna. So that is the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. It's the mercy of the whole parampara. How we're all gathered here. Srila Prabhupada, he gave his mercy. We'll find in so many letters, he wrote so many letters to disciples, and in so many letters, maybe hundreds of times, he wrote, chant 16 rounds daily, minimum, rise early, attend Mangal Arati, attend the class, all these things. Take only Krishna Prasadam. Again and again and again, he emphasized these things. So this is Prabhupada's mercy. That he gave all these practices so that we can remain steady in devotional service and grow in devotional service. Because if we don't, if we neglect these processes, then our devotional kripa withers away from lack of nourishment. The bhakti lata, the kripa of devotional service, that grows up being nourished by the water of shravan kirtan, hearing and chanting about Krishna. So unless water is regularly given, the plant will wither and die. So daily, we require hearing and chanting about Krishna in sufficient quantity. Otherwise, our devotional kripa doesn't grow or remains stunted or may die altogether. Of course, bhakti is never actually dies, but you may see some plants that in some trees in Europe, it's more or not more in climates further away from the equator. There are many trees that during the winter they appear dead. No leaves, no flowers, no fruits. And then again, when the warmer weather comes, when the conditions become favorable, then again they put forth leaves, fruits, flowers. Flowers come before the fruit, obviously. So in this way, our devotional service, if we don't properly hear and chant, if we don't follow all the principles, that will become stunted. So this is the first installment of understanding how we are to get the mercy. How can we get the mercy of Srila Prabhupada and all the acharyas? Well, the first thing is to just at least follow the basic things what they say, what they tell us to do. If we don't do that, and we ask for mercy, it's like expecting an honorary degree without making any effort, without showing any sincerity. So the sincerity will be shown by our endeavors in devotional service. And of course, those who do endeavor to spread Krishna consciousness and preach Krishna consciousness, they do get more mercy over and above the basic activities, those who endeavor to preach Krishna consciousness or to serve in a tivra, in a very intense way. It may not be preaching, or maybe pujari work, maybe the mother looking after her child. It's very intense service. If she's thinking how I can raise this child or these children in Krishna consciousness, so Krishna will also recognize that. If one is making sincere effort, one is not thinking of one's own personal comfort, but how Krishna's mission may be served, then one becomes eligible for more mercy, just like the example I gave of Tribhuvanath Prabhu. He wasn't officially a guru within ISKCON. He didn't initiate anyone. He didn't take sannyas. But still you'll find there are many devotees in England and Ireland who in their homes, on their altar they have his picture. Gopi Prandana Prabhu also, who taught so many devotees teachings of Shastra with firm adherence to Srila Prabhupada. Then you find that those, although he did initiate some devotees, but many others who are not officially initiated by him, they recognize him as their guru because he gave them the mercy which he had received from Srila Prabhupada. So this idea that the dispensation of mercy stops with Srila Prabhupada, it's a very anti-devotional idea, actually. In one sense, it's nice to recognize, of course, Srila Prabhupada's paramount position, but to do so by saying that, well, everyone else is useless, that's skewed logic or misplaced logic. We see those examples are there. Tribhuvanath Prabhu, Gopi Pranadanda Prabhu, very different devotees in many ways, but they're both examples of devotees who, even though who many consider their guru, even without the formality, without them being initiated by them, but just they've experienced in their lives how these devotees have given them Krishna consciousness, the life of Krishna consciousness, and the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. And without anyone telling them to, or asking them to, or suggesting to them that they've just automatically they feel that now they have passed away, so I don't have the opportunity to personally interact with them. So every day I'm offering arati, puja to Krishna, all the acharyas. So they also put the picture of Gopi Prandan Prabhu, Tribhuvanath Prabhu, because they naturally recognize that by the mercy of these devotees, I have received the mercy of all the previous acharyas. Now, the paramount position of Srila Prabhupada within our International Society of Krishna Consciousness, we should recognize that. Everyone is recognizing that. Then how to follow him? That example I gave yesterday, Srila Prabhupada repeated, it's a Bengali saying. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur used to say that. That the dancing girl will pull the veil over her face out of shyness. If one is to represent Srila Prabhupada by teaching what he taught, then you have to teach what he taught. You may think, well, I haven't realized that this material world is miserable. I'm still finding it quite enjoyable, so I shouldn't teach. Well, maybe if you are thinking like that, maybe you shouldn't teach. But we are supposed, those of us who have taken initiation in the Vaishnava Sampradaya, we are supposed to be following the teachings of Bhagavad Gita. So at least theoretically we have to accept. And it's not that difficult if we're so fortunate to have our eyes open with the torchlight of knowledge to understand that this world is a miserable place. We may have some residual desires to enjoy this world, but that doesn't mean that we should, that because we have in our hearts some illicit desires, that doesn't mean that we should not warn others of the damaging nature of the material world and of our misplaced propensity to try to enjoy it. We should tell others this material world is miserable. So again, that example of the dancing girl covering her, trying to be shy. A dancing girl means she's bold. So sometimes it's been said that, well, you should have low-key guru, but what does it mean? One has to preach the message of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam. The message itself is heavy. When we say guru is heavy, it doesn't necessarily mean that he's shouting at everyone and calling them bad names. May do that. But he's repeating the message of Shastra, which is very heavy. Of course, if one is repeating the message of Shastra, one has to act according to that. Otherwise, the teaching will not be, it won't impress on others. People will think, who is this person talking about the temporality and misery of this material world, but he's also enjoying it. Even now in India, even after this Rajneesh Kam Osho, even recently one so-called Swami was from South India was revealed or exposed in the press for some, what was there, some photo of him kissing a film star. I think it was something like that. Something like that. So even now, people have the understanding, this is not proper. They can understand, you have to behave properly. You can't be a swami and be a bhogi. The two things, you can't be a religious teacher or a guru and be an enjoyer of this material world. Of course, with Osho and this so-called Paramahamsa Nityananda, that was his name. If it goes on like this, then people will think that, well, that's what swamis do. Lock up your daughters when the swami comes around. Dangerous people. Just like in Croatia a few years ago, the local priest, about 30 years old, came around with his girlfriend. Right? And afterward I asked the devotees, well, don't the local people think that there's something strange? And no, they just think, they say, well, you know, it's normal. So, what is normal? What is normal is very dangerous. What is proper human behavior? What is the proper behavior of a sadhu? That we should learn from Shastra, not from vox populi. Especially in the modern age, it's just like there was a time not so long ago in India, not only in India, everywhere in the world, when abortion was considered very wrong. Contraception, artificial contraception, was considered sinful. But now that's changed. There was a time not very long ago in India where for a respectable woman to walk outside the house alone, especially after dark, was considered very wrong. Now that's changed. So what is considered wrong has become right. There was a time in India not very long ago when it was considered disgraceful if a man would even think of sending his wife to work. Now they stipulate the wife should go to work. This girl, if I'm to marry her, she must go to work. So what are the cultural norms? They change. All for the worse in modern society by the influence of Kali Yuga. But we, who are supposed to be followers of Shastra and the Acharyas, we should understand what is wrong and what is right. Tasmat Shastram Pramanam Te Karya Karya Vyavastita Gyatva Shastra Vidhanoktam Karya Karya Vivahasi. Knowing what is correct and what is not correct according to the injunctions of the Shastra, we should act in this world. So that may seem very heavy to go against the flow of modern society. But we have to follow Shastra. Otherwise, what's the meaning of being in Krishna consciousness? Otherwise, there are so many swamis who come and give katas, but they'll never mention that we're supposed to give up material enjoyment. So, guru means heavy, disciple means heavy. It's a pleasant heaviness if we accept our position as servants of Krishna, then it's very pleasant. And we don't care what these crazy people think. But if we are not convinced that we are meant to serve Krishna, then we'll find it a very heavy burden to practice Krishna consciousness. So if we try to lighten that load by not telling people, actually you have to give up sense gratification, you have to surrender to Krishna, you have to do this, you have to do, you don't have to, if we just don't tell them all those things, then we can be low-key gurus, or light gurus, which is a oxymoron. So, the problem is that if we cut out this and cut out that, then there's nothing left. Then it becomes like so many Hindu gurus, they'll say, Jai Shri Ram, Jai Jagadisha Hare. So it's nice, it's good. It's not bad, but it's not going to, it's not the intense, heavy Krishna consciousness that's going to cut our ties to this material world and bring us to Krishna. So, whether we are fully qualified or not fully qualified, we should at least, we should preach what is given in Shastra, knowing that this is the fact, and act according to the direction of Shastra. It's not that difficult to do. It's not impossibly difficult to imbibe that consciousness. And the more devotees do that, the more we find it, that we get support for doing so. Sange Shakti Kalo Yuge. In Kali Yuga, we get strength from association. Srila Prabhupada went to the West alone. It's not generally recommended that devotees go alone anywhere. Of course, Srila Prabhupada, he kept association with his spiritual master and all the previous acharyas by his strong bond of commitment to serve them. And gradually a few people came to Srila Prabhupada, and then gradually more and more and more. And when there are more, then there's a group, and then they attract others also. So it's quite possible that at any point in time, many thousands and maybe even millions of people can take to Krishna consciousness. We find here in India, wherever we go, there's so many people who we can just by being with them for a short time, we can understand that if they're given more association, they can take up Krishna consciousness. And in other parts of the world also, not so much as in India, but so we don't have to, this idea we have to make things easy, cheap, but just give the real thing as it is, that will be appreciated. There are so many bogus people going around saying all kinds of bogus things and giving insubstantial teachings, just meant to cheat people. If we have what Srila Prabhupada and all the acharyas and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Shastra have given us, then why not give that? Don't think that others can't do it, it's too difficult. There's nothing difficult. They may find it difficult. But everyone can do it. It's not that giving up onions and garlic and meat and tea and coffee, it's not such a difficult thing. Instead of trying to avoid telling people all these things, tell them and say, yes, You can do it. Assure them you can do it. I did it. I'm nothing special. I'm just coming from an ordinary background like you. You can do it. You will be benefited by doing so. That is preaching. Preaching is not to avoid telling people what they should do, what they need to do for their spiritual uplift, but to tell them and encourage them and show them how it's possible. Maybe they may not do it immediately, but they can at least gradually get the idea. Otherwise, they won't even have the idea if no one tells them. Or it may be just dormant in their mind. Just like you told me, what was that? Some devotees from Salem, they went in one college and they preached that this, they told all the students, this meat eating is not good. And 30 of them on the spot gave up meat eating. That means they had some idea that it was not good, but no one told them. Then you told them, and then, all right, they're immediately ready to stop that. So we shouldn't think that people can't do it, or they won't like to hear it, therefore we shouldn't tell them. They may not like to hear it, but they need to hear it. Again, the example of the doctor, his duty is to give what people need, not what they like. And actually what they need is what they really like. Shreyas and prayas. Krishna bhakti is both shreyas and prayas. Shreyas is that which seems nice immediately, but in the long run is not good for us. And prayas is that which is actually good for us in the long run, which may not immediately seem good. But bhakti is both immediately is very pleasing and in the long term also. So in this way, with faith in the message of Krishna, that people can take it, they will take it. Maybe everyone won't take it. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't go on speaking it. And we don't know who will take it. It may be people we think are quite unlikely who do take to Krishna consciousness. So this is what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu meant when he said, Jare dekho tare kaha Krishna upadesh amar agyai guru haya tara idesh. When Krishna upadesh means the teachings of Bhagavad Gita as given by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So we should teach that, not anything else. If we teach anything else, then we're not following Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. If we adjust it this way, little way, then it all becomes spoiled. So I had so many things to say, but I don't know if... Where's the time to say so many things? Oh, yeah, there's some other point. All right, I have a little more time. Huh? Up to what time? 10 o'clock, is it? Yeah, I heard recently that some devotees in our movement are talking about demystifying the role of guru. How do you translate that? That gurus should... We should have many gurus, and they may not be on such a high level, but at least everyone gets to see their guru. And maybe like an ordinary person, just like, you know, you see your father every day. And it's not like a mystic relationship. It's just, he's your father, that's all. But how is this going to work? What's the shastric basis for this idea, demystifying the role of guru? Because Krishna, he says, Acharyang mang vijaniya navamanyeta karhi chitna martya buddhya suyeta sarvadeva maya guru. Krishna says, you should know very well that the Guru is me. That means he's the representative of Krishna. He should not be even slightly neglected, insulted, or thought of in a demeaning manner. Should not be considered an ordinary human being. Should not be envied. Should be considered, or not exactly, Krishna doesn't even say that should be considered, but he says he is. Sarva Devamai. He's the all the demigod, all the devotees, he is made up of them. Now Krishna spoke this in the, we find this in the Srimad Bhagavatam, in the description of the brahmachari who lives with his guru, living with his guru every day. The guru would, this kind of guru would mostly be married with a few disciples. You may say like an ordinary person. So even if in many ways he seems ordinary, Krishna says you don't see him as ordinary. Even though you see he eats, he sleeps, sometimes falls sick, sometimes gets angry, sometimes may appear to be mistaken in some ways about some things. But Krishna says, you should know him as me. Well, that's, how can you demystify that? How, what is the mysticism, or the, how should we say mysticism? Achintya vichar. That the guru is as good as God, but he just appears to be like a human being. But you're not, you can't see like that, because Krishna says, you're not, you don't see like that. But Krishna says, as good as me. So there's no question of demystifying, unless we want to de-guruize the guru, and there's not a guru anymore. If he's going to teach about Krishna, then that example is there of the iron rod in the fire. By contact with fire, has the same effect as fire. Though it's an iron rod, but if you take that iron rod and touch it to someone's arm, then it becomes burned. It has the same effect as fire. An iron rod doesn't normally burn, but because of its intense, prolonged association with fire, it acts as fire. So in the same way, an ordinary human being doesn't, is just an ordinary human being, is not God, but one who teaches about Krishna, both by practice and by precept, they become as good as Krishna for the disciple. That doesn't mean in every respect. It doesn't mean he's the creator and maintainer and destroyer of the three worlds, or that he's dancing with the gopis. Not in that sense, Krishna. But in the sense that if one hears from a representative of Krishna in a bona fide parampara, who is upholding and maintaining the principles of the parampara, then one can get the same result by hearing from and serving that guru as Arjuna got by directly hearing from Krishna. So that is the meaning of the guru being as good as Krishna. So there's no question of demystifying or just having some kind of this idea that you have some normal kind of relationship. Because in the Western world, no one respects anyone, hardly. It's considered below anyone's dignity to respect anyone else. They might respect someone who's a famous football player is respected. Some famous TV personality, they may be respected. So they do have some respect, but for the wrong people and for the wrong reasons. But that culture is there that one should see Guru as good as God. Of course, that may be misused. There's great potential for misuse. But that doesn't mean that we should scratch out from Srimad Bhagavatam or edit it out the statement of Krishna that one should see the Guru as good as God. And how does he see himself? He doesn't see himself as good as God. He sees himself as the servant of the servant of the servant of the servant of the devotees of Krishna and thinks himself very fortunate to be in that situation. So this culture has to be there, that the position of Guru is open, it's open to misuse, doesn't mean that it should be abolished or redefined. Rather, those who, upon whom that role devolves, they should carry it out properly. Upon whom that role devolves, I'll explain that, that is the normal thing, just like when a man dies, his sons, especially the eldest son, they manage his estate, and the eldest son becomes the head of the family. So a Vaishnav never dies, but when a Vaishnav guru departs from this world, then it's the responsibility of his disciples to carry on teaching what he taught. It's not that someone tries to be a guru or is appointed a guru. Of course, within ISKCON at the present time, there is not exactly appointment, but there's some approval system that's necessary for an institution. But it's the responsibility of every disciple to give what he has received to others. And what is the system for doing that? To take the role of guru as described in Shastra. Now there are modern ideas. The teacher, it's a paid job. He goes into the classroom, doesn't give a damn about the pupils. They don't give a damn about him. He's just waiting till it's over. They're just waiting till it's over. There's no affection exchanged between them. He doesn't care whether they pass or not. So that's the modern role of a teacher. The guru is not just a teacher in the modern sense. Guru Devatatma. Again, Krishna says that one should accept the guru as one's very life, because he gives us life. So all these injunctions are in the Shastra. Maybe not very easy to live up to, but that doesn't mean that we should scrap them. Rather, we should come up to that level. We find everywhere in Shastra, there are Rama, Lakshman, how they accompanied Vishwamitra. He was naturally young boys. They looked up to, respected, and served him. Great Rishi. And he taught them as they were walking along the path. So we find that everywhere. Krishna himself showed, although he is the reservoir of all knowledge and the very object of knowing in the Vedic literature, he himself went to a guru, served his guru. We should all try to be disciples as Krishna was. Krishna said to himself, Krishnam Vande Jagat Guru. He's the guru of the whole world, of the whole universe, of everything and everyone. He himself showed how to be a disciple. And he got a approval from his guru. His guru didn't say, well, your God, I won't teach you. What is that? Etanevi satshishai kartavyam guru nishkritam. Savai sarva bhavena. Sarvat atmarpanam guru. Now this Sandipani Muni said to Krishna and Sudama. This defining what is the satshishya, real disciple, proper disciple. This is the proper duty of the disciple. His duty, kartavyam, to repay his debt to his guru by, in all respects, offering everything he has and his very self to his guru. So that is a very sweet exchange to say, well, we don't want to have too much of all this guru stuff. Now are the days of democracy. Don't like your guru? Okay, well, never mind. But that is a very sweet exchange. That's Krishna accepts bhakti if it's directed via his devotees. Otherwise he doesn't accept it. So this giving Krishna, even though one is unqualified, who can give Krishna? But Krishna comes as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and says to give Krishna. Amar agyai guru hoya tara e desh. So you have to do according to your ability. Ability may not be much, but if you, as Srila Prabhupada explained, if you follow purely, the same effect is there. So, to give Krishna, knowledge of Krishna, practice of Krishna consciousness to others, and naturally that is a very pleasing exchange. The disciple feels grateful if they apply themselves in service. It's such a sweet exchange that, just like Krishna, he went to the forest amid great difficulty with a storm, And then he didn't come back and say, well, look, you know, I went to so much trouble for you, and who do you think you are? But rather, he thought that by the Guru's mercy, we're able to live very happily in this world. So devotees, they're disciples, they're meant to sacrifice and take difficulties. I heard it said that once a devotee said to Srila Prabhupada, that, Prabhupada, I've given my whole life to you. And Prabhupada said, I already know that. That's what it is. I gave my whole life. Well, that's what you're supposed to. That's what every disciple does. That, otherwise, you're not a disciple at all. So it's, one has to fully surrender and give oneself, and then think that whatever I'm getting, whatever I'm able to do in Krishna's service, that's all the mercy of the Guru. Give everything and not take any credit for oneself. And if one thinks there's credit for myself, then we don't actually get the real thing. We don't get Krishna's mercy. Krishna's mercy comes from the humility or the reality of thinking that I have nothing. Whatever I have, that is simply coming by the mercy of Guru. So that's just normal. In the Western world, sometimes people get annoyed when they see disciples serving gurus. They think it's below human dignity that they should do so. One of my sannyasi godbrothers told me he was sitting, taking prasadam in Australia with, it's a Sunday feast, and devotee was serving him. And he told him, bring some of this, bring some of that. And someone, a member of the public, objected. What are you doing, ordering him around like that? They have no idea of this culture, that you just serve and serve and serve. What this so-called human dignity? That is your dignity to have the opportunity to serve. That's a normal thing. It was a common thing until recently, that disciples, they were, during the night, no electric fan, disciple would fan all night. They wouldn't think, they'd fan the guru all night, then he's resting and then he gets up. So you wouldn't think, well, then it's too much, but just a normal thing, service. And by doing so, even the guru, it's not that he has to profusely say thank you and this, that, thank you very much, but just acknowledge, that's all. All right, very good. You did your duty. And by doing so, selflessly, one gets the mercy of the guru. It's also possible to do it with some ulterior motive, thinking I'll personally serve the guru and then after he passes away, I'll become the next guru. That may be the ulterior motives. Then I will be served. One may think like that. But that will not attract the mercy of the Guru. Or one may get the mercy in a different way. As Srila Prabhupada said, that some of my godbrothers, they got the mercy of my Guru Maharaj. They got the buildings and the position and the institution. They got all that. But I got the mercy to preach Krishna consciousness all over the world. And actually, Srila Prabhupada had more buildings and institutions and followers than those who Srila Prabhupada said had got themselves into that position to do so. So service, selfless service, that is the duty of every disciple. And then in the natural course of service, in the absence of his guru, when the guru is no longer present in this world, he continues to serve by continuing the mission. Just like the child becomes a father in due course, so the disciple becomes a guru in due course. He never stops being a disciple. He never thinks, now I am a guru. But he always thinks, I am a disciple. And in this way, teaches others. In this way, teaches others. Always remembering, Jogata Bichare Kichu Nahipai Tomara Karunasha. Always thinking that, as Srila Prabhupada himself, even Srila Prabhupada felt like that. I was most immensely qualified. I have no personal qualification. I simply tried to serve my Guru Maharaj. So by performing that service, by the mercy of the Hari Guru Vaishnava, one may be elevated, should be elevated, to the service of Krishna, to the platform of relishing Krishna consciousness. Of tasting the sweetness of Krishna consciousness. Chaitanya Lila, what is that? Krishna Lila, Amritapur. No, Chaitanya Lila, Amritapur, Krishna Lila, Shukarpur, Duhe Mile Hoi Sumadhurja. Guru Sadhu Prasade Taha Jayashade Shei Pai Madhurja Prachurja. In Chaitanya Charitamrita it said that Chaitanya Leela is just like nectar. And the Krishna Leela is like nectar drink. Milk cooked very nicely with rice. Sweetened, and then in that light, considering the pastimes of Krishna, that is like putting a little drop of camphor, which when that is added, then it becomes very sweet and very tasty. So this is the analogy given. Then by the mercy of the gurus and the sadhus, whoever tastes that, se jane madhurja prachurja. Madhurja prachurja. Such a person can experience immense sweetness. So we're all meant for that. Amritaputra, we're all meant for tasting the nectar. That is possible by the mercy of the gurus and sadhus. That is what they come to give. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu comes to give. Krishna Prema. Namo Mahavadanyaya Krishna Prema Pradayate Krishnaya Krishna Chaitanya Namne Gauratvishe Namo. So by the mercy of the guru and the devotees, we can hope this Radhika Madhava Sham, this Nama Shrestham Manamapi Satchiputra Matra Srupam Rupam Tasyagajam Urupring Matarim Goshtamatim Radha Kundam Girivaramaho Radhika Madhava Sham Prapto Yasya Pratita Kripaya Srigaruntam Natosva. We pray to the Guru by whose great mercy we have the hope or the expectation of service to, association with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all his principal associates, the service to the holy name, Hare Krishna mantra, up to the level of service at Radha Kund, of Radhika Madhava. So all that is there by the mercy of gurus and devotees. That possibility is there. But even if we come to the level, what should we perform in Krishna Leela? We're not at that level of discussing that now. Or rather, we can serve Krishna Leela as it's going on now, the Sankirtan movement. Even if one comes to the highest platform, we should all come to the highest platform. That's what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu comes to this world for, what Prabhupada comes to this world for, to bring us up to that highest level. Even then, always remember, Jogyata Bichare Kichu Nahi Pai Tomara Karunasha. However far one may go in devotional service, how far can you go? It's unlimited. But always remember,